Good morning. How good it is to be together in a spirit of worship on this Pentecost Sunday. I'm so glad so many of you got the memo and are wearing your red. Those of you that aren't, it's okay. There's plenty around us to create a sea of red. What a wonderful and important and exciting day it is in the life of our church and also in the life of the Church Universal. We've got a lot going on this morning. As I said, it's Pentecost Sunday. It's Reverend Dale Davis's last Sunday among us as our interim senior pastor. So we will take time in the midst of our service to celebrate him, his ministry among us, and his ministry of over 40 years. What a wonderful thing. This morning we are going to keep the announcements light. I know you're going to miss them. They'll be back next week. But there are some announcements listed in your bulletin, and I do, of course, encourage you to pay attention to those after the service, not during the service. But there are just a few reminders I want to let you know. After our service, there's quite a spread being prepared downstairs in honor of Reverend Dale, so please plan to attend. The best news of all, no offense, Dale, but the elevator's working. And we're really excited about it. I know it might sound silly if you haven't been here for a few weeks, but our elevator wasn't working for a while, and it really put a hindrance on our community. So please make your way downstairs, not all of you at once in the elevator, but we will have someone there just in case something were to go wrong, but very excited about that. Also want to welcome to join in our worship this morning Reverend Bill Worley, who's the conference minister of our Pennsylvania Southeast Conference. He's here leading worship with us this morning, and it is an honor to lead worship with him. So we want to offer a welcome to Reverend Bill. I believe those are all of the announcements that I have this morning. So as always, I'm going to invite you to join me in taking a deep and slow and very intentional breath. As we breathe in God's Holy Spirit that fills this place, a spirit that fills each one of us as we gather to worship, as you take a moment to exhale, try your best to set aside all the things that are busying your heart and your mind and preventing you from being present in this time and in this place, as we prepare our hearts and minds to worship this morning. I'm going to invite you now to stand and join me in our responsive call to worship. They were all together in one place when it happened. The entire house was filled. Suddenly, when it was least expected, the Holy Spirit filled everyone. A sound like the rush of a violent wind, but something different. And tongues like fire, but not fire itself. Something was indeed happening, everyone amazed and perplexed. Right then and there came the birth of the church, a moment when empowerment touched everyone.
Would you join with me now in our confession? God of creation, nurture, and empowerment, the coming of the Holy Spirit wasn't a fluke, a chance occurrence. No, those who came together on Pentecost did so because they waited patiently on the promise, devoted themselves to the work of prayer, and lived with abundant expectation. Can we say the same of ourselves, or have we come to the place in which we have lost sight of God's precious mission, given up on the promise of empowerment, and lost sight of the world we are called to serve? God, forgive our low expectations, apathy, and indifference to the life you have called us to live. We long to feel your power, presence, and corporate purpose in our lives. We long to be the body of Christ you envisioned, not self-serving, but instead life-giving. Lord, hear our prayer. Sometimes we are just too overwhelmed, disoriented, and don't know where to begin when it comes to reorienting our spiritual lives. Simply confessing and letting God know begins our return to God and to our true selves. We are forgiven.
Be seated. Our scripture reading this morning are the familiar words of Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 21. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind. And it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every people under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked,
"Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia, and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and the visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs in our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power."
All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another,
"What does this mean?"
But others sneered and said,
"They are filled with new wine."
But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them.
"Fellow Jews, and all who live in Jerusalem,
Let this be known to you, and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved.
At this time, I would like to invite the children to come forward and join me, and Reverend Dale, while you're up here. Come on up. I saw a few of our friends had to leave. Hopefully they'll join us. Have a seat. How's everyone doing? Good? It's finally sunny. I'm glad it's not raining, aren't you? Yeah, me too. Well, in our rather dramatic and exciting scripture reading we just heard, right? We don't often hear sounds of the organ when we're reading scripture. But it's an exciting day in the life of our church, and not just our church, but the whole big church. And we're gonna talk a little bit about that in just a minute. But it is a day called Pentecost. It's after Easter, right? 5 weeks after Easter, which is why the word Penta is in there, like Pentagon with five sides. So after Easter, and it's a day when we actually call it the birthday of the church. Did you know that? Now you have a birthday, right? Everybody has a birthday. But the church also has a birthday, not just St. John's, but the whole big church, like I was talking about before. And we call it the birthday of the church because it's really a day when the disciples realize their call is to take what they've learned from Jesus and to go out into the world and spread the good news. Now, you might be thinking, yeah, that was kind of the deal all along, but this is where the church really starts to sort of explode. And it goes all over the world, and the good news is really spread. So we call it the birthday of the church because we're here at St. John's are the result of that thousands of years ago, of that spreading of the good news. And guess what? That's still our job. All these years later, it is still our job to go out and spread the good news. Now, it's also Reverend Dale's last Sunday with us. You knew that, right? Yeah. And of course, that's sad. I find myself feeling sad about that because Reverend Dale isn't going to be here every Sunday anymore. Yeah? And that makes me sad. So I have some good news and bad news, and I'm going to suggest we start with the bad news, which we just kind of heard about. The bad news is, Reverend Dale, we won't get to see you every week. You won't be offering our children's lessons anymore. You won't be on our Zoom calls and meetings, which I know you're really going to miss. But I do have good news. So Reverend Dale, the bad news is Reverend Dale won't be coming and part of this church anymore. But the good news is, because of Pentecost, because of God's Holy Spirit that unites each and every single person on the face of the earth, Reverend Dale is still a member of our church. Because we all belong, not just to St. John's, but to the bigger church. You know how there's like a church on every corner in Lansdale? Well, there's a churches on a lot of corners in the United States, in the whole world, and guess what? We all belong to the same big church because of the Holy Spirit, because we all believe in one God and one Savior Jesus and one Holy Spirit. And I just think that's really good news. We don't ever really have to say goodbye to anyone who leaves our congregation because we all still belong. So as we say goodbye to Reverend Dale, we're going to welcome the Holy Spirit in, and the Holy Spirit is going to make sure that we stay connected forever. And that's good news. That's really good news. So let's join in prayer, and then we'll say our Lord's Prayer together. Loving God, on this Pentecost day, we give you thanks for the sun that is shining, for your Holy Spirit that is moving and uniting and just doing such wonderful things in our church, in our world, and in our midst. God, as we prepare to say goodbye to Reverend Dale, and as we think of the wonderful times we have had with him, we give you thanks that even though he will no longer be a part of our church at St. John's, he will forever be a part of not only our lives and our hearts, but also of the great big church that you have made. Thank you, God, for all the ways you keep us connected. All of these things we pray in Christ's name, the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you so much for joining me, and head back to your seats.
Well, I'm so glad we're together today. I'm going to miss you. The movie Apollo 13 is a fairly accurate reenactment of what actually happened during the week between April 11th and 17th back in 1970. Apollo 13 never made it to the moon. It had to abort its mission while millions of people anxiously followed reports of a series of disabling breakdowns that placed the spacecraft in seemingly constant peril. And during one scene in the movie, Mission Control in Houston, Texas, learns that the carbon dioxide levels in the lunar module where the crew was located had hit toxic levels because of the failure of a carbon dioxide filter cartridge. There weren't replacement parts on the spaceship. And so Mission Control gathered almost everyone they could into one room. And then a large box containing everything that was available on the spaceship for the astronauts to build a filter from scratch was emptied onto the table. And the Mission Control team was given the task of doing something they never thought was possible: creating a solution to something in which there was no textbook or service manual. And they miraculously came up with a solution. They figured out how to build a filter. And then right away they radioed up to the crew with instructions on how to build it. It worked. And it saved the crew of Apollo 13. In April of 1970, I, along with tens of thousands of people, watched nervously as the space crew safely landed in the South Pacific. It's a story of the power of everyone being on the same page. The story of Pentecost is also a story about everyone suddenly discovering that they are on the same page. Pentecost is a story of empowerment. It is a story in which everyone experiences the same thing, the same word, the same direction, the same vision, the same mission. Everyone is in the same place, psychically and spiritually. Of course, it's disorienting and perplexing at first. What is this? Why is this happening? The cynical folks, they think it's an absurd dream full of drunks. The Apostle Peter, however, knows it to be the birth of purpose, clarity, and fulfillment. Before this moment, Jesus' followers, they mourned, they grieved, they wondered, they doubted, they waited, and they hoped following his death. And in the moment of Pentecost, the church was birthed. It was a moment when vocation, clarity, purpose, and all the resources that would be necessary suddenly emerged. And what I love, what I absolutely love about the story of Pentecost is that everyone was reminded that they had everything they needed. Like that group gathered at Mission Control in Houston, Pentecost is the moment in which everyone knows what is at stake. Every person of faith is like items from the box that was poured onto the table at Mission Control in order to figure out how to join God in the work of rescuing a world. A world in which the best laid plans have run afoul. Instead of rescuing a space crew, the church was empowered to join God in rescuing a world that has lost its direction, is running out of precious resources, and is running out of time. There is an existential crisis in the world. So if not now, when? I'd like to offer a few ideas with respect to the church. I've been privileged to serve my entire life, and particularly as a pastor and teacher over the last 40 years. At its best, the church discerns and manages a polarity. At one pole lies stability. And at the other pole lies the Spirit. And it is a tension that has created unnecessary struggles, heartache, and yes, heartburn. The Spirit, on the one hand, is about empowerment, it's about movement, it's about change, it's about adaptation, it's about fulfilling the purpose. God is communicating. God is still speaking. Stability, on the other hand, is about order, predictability, certainty, and no surprises. Institutions such as the church tend to gravitate towards maintaining stability. You don't get in trouble for maintaining stability. You get rewarded for stability. You get rewarded for certainty. And yet, as is often the case, churches become overly preoccupied with managing stability. They focus on stability at the expense of losing sight of the mission. And that legitimate tension, that natural tension between spirit and stability collapses. It collapses in one direction, and the church often becomes captive to stability. Brothers, sisters, and siblings, this is why the Holy Spirit, this is why the Spirit of God is so vitally important. The Spirit is the voice. It is the disruption. It is the inconvenience. It is the wake-up call. It is the part of the church's soul that rightfully claims attention. It comes out of nowhere and it seeks to be heard. Call it spirit, wind, or as the Hebrews called it, ruach, or as the Greeks called it, pneuma. Whatever you call it, its job is to point the direction, light the fire, ignite the passion, flame the mission. At the beginning, at the very beginning of Jesus' ministry, the Gospel of Mark records these words, "And the Spirit immediately drove him into the wilderness." Jesus was not given a strategic plan. He was not given a questionnaire asking for his preferences. He didn't participate in endless meetings in which everything was managed for control and predictability and certainty. No, 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 the Spirit. The Spirit erupted in Jesus' life. And it erupted in the life of the early church. And as the author of the book of Acts and the Gospel of Luke dared to write, and I quote, you will receive power. And you will be witnesses to the end of the earth. That is bold. That is courageous. That is daring. That is passion. That is purpose. Now, don't get me wrong. God likes stability. God likes order. God likes planning. And God likes process. And at the same time, and along with these things, God is also for movement. God is for creativity. God is for passion. God is for innovation. God is for daring. God is for risk-taking. Dare I say it, God is all about doing a new thing. The key is to embrace both of these polarities. Embrace stability and spirit. And don't push one or the other into the corner. Now, at one moment during the Apollo 13 movie, one of the members of Mission Control talks to the Apollo 13 crew. And he says, and I quote here, crew, we have an unusual procedure for you here, but we need you to rip the cover off the flight plan. You see, they needed that cover. They needed the cover because that was one of the components of the new filter. The spirit was speaking, and the flight plan, well, that had to be adapted. And so, here's my word to you, my beloved siblings in Christ. I say this with such love. Be nimble. Be flexible. Be experimental. Because today's congregations are not facing a problem that they need to fix or solve. No, churches are facing a condition, a reality that they must embrace. They need to tear the cover off the plan, the procedures, the protocols, and pay attention to what the Spirit is telling them. They need to let their souls speak. Over 40 years, I've been told by members of various churches that I've loved and served, I've been told what needs to be done. What has to happen? We need more young families. We need more members. We need, in the words of an old expression, more nickels and more noses. And yet, according to the book of Acts, nickels and noses is not what is most needed. Instead, what was needed and is still needed is empowerment, direction, passion, imagination, all the things the Spirit gives. The Spirit is giving this to you. Now, here's a little factoid. Before the Pentecost event, and before any major event happens in the early church, according to the book of Acts, people gather to pray. What a novel thing. They pray. They wait non-anxiously. They listen. And they share. And instead of them trying to make it happen, you know, pushing the elephant up the stairs, instead of them trying to, quote, make it happen, they allow God to make it happen in them. And that's one thing I have to confess that I didn't always do. You see, I have my own brokenness, my own failures, seduced into thinking that working harder for God will guarantee an outcome. No, 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 Dale. No, no. No, listening to God, listening to my soul speak, listening to my community speak. Yeah, God makes it happen. Churches get way too preoccupied with resources and preservation, and that's a false anxiety. How do you know what resources you'll need if you don't have a picture of the difference you are being called to make? What every church has to point them in the direction of their true purpose comes from Jesus himself. It's very simple. Focus on the most vulnerable, the most hurting, and the least privileged people in your communities. Jesus, by the way, was not the first one to offer words to this effect. The Hebrew Scriptures, what you and I refer to as the Old Testament, offers very similar wisdom from the prophets. I'm thinking of the prophet Jeremiah in particular. This is the purpose. This is the purpose for the people of God according to Jeremiah. Seek the welfare of the place where I have sent you into exile and pray to the Lord on its behalf. For in its welfare, you will find your welfare. If the church seeks to save itself, it will become non-existent. But if it loses itself in serving the weakest members of society, it will surely find life, and life abundant. And that is good news. Amen.
Please be seated. As we move into our time of prayer this morning, I would like to lift up just one concern that's been lifted in our book, and that concern is for Aubrey, who received a prayer shawl this week. So as you know, a prayer shawl ministry sends prayer shawls far and wide, and so Aubrey was the recipient of one, so we, of course, surround her for whatever it is her need is. Knowing, of course, we all come to this time of prayer with our own joys and concerns on our hearts and minds, I want to invite you to bring those to mind now as we lift them up to God together in prayer. Great living God, as we come to you in prayer, we pray that our senses might be opened to the presence and movement of your Holy Spirit all around us. In the stillness of this sacred place, in the busyness and noise of the world outside, in the joys and celebrations of our lives, in the tragedies and struggles that break our hearts, come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, and comfort those who grieve this day. Grant them the peace that only you can bring. Stir within each of us a trust in life beyond death. Hope in new and everlasting life. Come, Holy Spirit, and bring wholeness to the sick. Strengthen those who are weak. Heal the wounded and broken, give rest to the weary. Come, Holy Spirit, and inspire our warring world to seek peace, to love our enemies, to put away our weapons, to remember the price paid for our freedom, to care for those who have served. Come, Holy Spirit, and ignite a fire in our bones, a passion for justice, until all of your children are loved, until no one is marginalized or oppressed, until everyone has the opportunity to thrive and grow, until the world is transformed and renewed. Come, Holy Spirit, revive your church. Liberate us from complacency and apathy and anxiety. Inspire us with Christ's vision for a world reborn. Help us to recognize our gifts for ministry and to use them in service of others. Transform our hearts and our minds. Fill us with love that overflows. Remind us that there is no greater calling than to love you with all that we are and to love our neighbors as ourselves. Gracious God, give us a glimpse of your kingdom emerging around us and drawing us into the new things you are surely doing in this world. All of these things we pray in the name of Christ, trusting in the Spirit and relying upon your love. Amen. We now have the opportunity to give, so I would like to receive this morning's offering.
Thank you.
O gracious God, you are the master gardener of the world. You have planted these seeds of love within us, and we offer them back to your spirit, to your world, knowing that you will grow them, that you will nurture them, and that your kingdom will unfold in ways unimaginable. So bless these gifts, bless our spirits, and may we give Christ the Lord our thanks. Amen.
Please be seated.
Everyone is invited to this table. Everyone is welcomed to this feast. It is a feast of celebration, a feast of thanksgiving. It is a moment when you and I remember Jesus and his vocation. Jesus lived his vocation not out of sheer will, but through listening. Not my will, but God, your will. And so listening to that gracious, loving God brings us to this meal. And so we celebrate and give thanks.
I want to invite you to follow along to the liturgy in our bulletins. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. You who come to me shall not hunger. You who believe in me shall never thirst."
In the company of all who hunger for spiritual food, we come to this table to know the risen Christ in the sharing of this life-giving bread and in the sharing of the cup.
God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to God Most High.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
For thousands of years, this tradition has been passed down to us. This Christ, who nurtures us, who feeds us, who sacrificed for us. We remember that on the night of his betrayal and desertion, Jesus took bread. And after he had given God thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
And in the same way, after breaking bread, Jesus took the cup. And after giving thanks for it and blessing it and before sharing it with those he loved, he said to his disciples, "This is my blood, poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you do this, do it in remembrance of me."
We join together in a spirit of prayer. Holy God, send your spirit upon these simple gifts. The gift of grains gathered from the field and of grapes from the vine. May they become powerful symbols of your mystical presence, working transformation and empowerment and healing and grace in our lives and through us in the world. We pray this in Jesus' name and by the power of his resurrected spirit. Amen.
Amen.
A few important details about communion this morning. We will be receiving communion by means of intinction, so there will be two communion stations in either transept, one in each transept. So after I'm finished sharing these details, I'm going to invite our four communion servers to come forward. Make your way out the center aisle, up the front, and then around to the sides, and return to your seats by means of the side aisle. Within each chalice, there is just grape juice. If you are in need of gluten-free elements, there will be a basket of those at either station. If you would like individually wrapped elements, you're also getting gluten-free elements, and they will also be at either station. Let me think of any other details I need to remember. Choir and everyone in the chancel, you can stay put. Reverend Dale and Reverend Bill will be coming to serve you. If coming forward is not a good idea for you for whatever reason, please feel free to stay in your seats. I will be making my way around sharing communion with those who need to stay seated, so not to worry. I believe those are all of our little details, so I want to invite you to come, for all things are now ready.
Let us give thanks in a spirit of prayer. Holy and gracious God, we thank you for refreshing us at your table with these gifts. We pray that they will continue to nourish us in the hours, days, and weeks to come. Bless us as we celebrate the joy of the Spirit, and help us always and everywhere to live between the gifts of stability and spirit at all times and all places. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please be seated.
Get you a mic. I'll get you a mic.
Good morning, everyone. Well, I want to thank you very much for this opportunity to lead off the celebration of Pastor Dale's 40 years of ministry. And his ministry with us here at St. John's. In 2022, first of all, my name is Liz Rivett, and in 2022, I was council vice president and also leading the transition team that was called to search for our interim senior pastor. And so in 2022, we interviewed several candidates, but either they were not a fit for us or we were not a fit for them. Our team was getting nervous, realizing that we would be facing a gap in pastoral leadership. Them and Pastor Addy would be carrying a very heavy burden over the summer, and our work was ongoing. Reverend Kevin McLemore, who leads Search and Call for the Penn Southeast Conference, continued to provide support to us and was working feverishly behind the scenes. One day, he contacted us and said, "I think I found someone." And that someone was Pastor Dale. The first time I spoke with Dale, it was a lovely June afternoon, but we had a bad connection, if I remember correctly. It took a couple ties for us to get that right. So I moved into my backyard to get a better signal. We talked about an hour, I think, but it certainly felt like a short call. Flew by. His calmness and confidence impressed me, and I thought, just don't say anything to screw this up. No pressure. The key questions I had for Dale were, are you really willing to postpone your retirement to come serve with us? And to stay for 18 to 24 months? Because we knew it would take that long. And is this what God is calling you to do? Fortunately, the answer to these questions were yes. Within 2 weeks, Dale was able to meet with the transition team, speak with Addy, and we finalized arrangements for him joining us in September. I'm pretty sure Dale did not actually know what he was getting into when he answered that call. But I could also tell that his leadership and outside perspective were exactly what St. John's needed. While we were a strong community of faith, there were areas of ministry and leadership that had not received the attention they deserved in recent years, or had been concentrated in a small number of people. He explained transparently, compassionately, patiently, and I think repeatedly, about his role as an interim to a congregation that had not had an interim senior pastor in over 40 years. I personally appreciated Dale's incredible passion for and knowledge of organizational behavior. Dale, if you had been in the business world, your consulting skills would have been in very high demand. You showed us how a church functions differently than other organizations and how we could rethink leadership and governance. You have challenged us to recognize what mainstream religion looks like in today's culture and think critically about what St. John's place is in it. We heard that very much in your sermon today. So Dale, it is my sincere hope and personal commitment that the work you have started here will continue to grow and bear fruit for our church family and our broader Lansdale community for years to come. Helen, thank you very much for sharing Dale with us for the last 20 months. I know that was a sacrifice for you, and I thank you from the bottom of my heart. Dale, I wish you all the best in your retirement.
Thank you, Liz.
Oops, there you are.
As we gather today to celebrate with Reverend Dale as he retires after a long career ministering to God's people, I would like to take a moment to thank Dale for his service to St. John's. You joined us in fall of 2022 when we were grieving the loss of our pastor of many years. We were just starting this long process of transition at that time, and you've helped bring St. John's through this phase of reflection and visioning for the future. We still have more to do to complete the process, but you have helped give us a firm foundation. As a token of gratitude for service to us, here is a gift from us at St. John's.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Mark.
Thank you again for sharing your wisdom and talents with us. Relax and enjoy your retirement.
I have, thank you, Mark Bruin. Thank you, Liz Rivett. I have a couple of folks that I want to thank and then invite my colleagues to maybe offer a word. I want to thank my family, my wife, Helen, my son, Cameron, my daughter, Hannah, my son-in-law, Michael. They have been so vitally life-giving to me. And I just want you to know how much I love you. And you have been on this part of this 40-year journey yourself, so you know what the Spirit will do. I want to thank members of former churches that I have served here in the Penn Southeast Conference, Emmanuel United Church of Christ in Shillington. We've got some folks who are here from Emmanuel. We have some folks from Wences United Church of Christ down the road. Some dear, dear friends are with us today. And then the shocker, well, just so many friends from the Reading area, but the shocker was to have my seminary classmate, my go-to best friend, suddenly appear out of nowhere with his wife, Tom and Patrice Ott. I'm just sort of blown away. Just stand up. They got to take a look at you.
First of all, Dale, I want to thank you for your sermon today. It was among the best I've ever heard, not just from you, but in general, and what a word it was for me and for all of us. On Reverend Dale's first Sunday with us, he preached about about church being a school of love. Do you remember that? Church is a school of love, a place where we come to learn how to walk in the footsteps of Christ. Not a place we come to only when we've got it all figured out, but a place that we come to figure it out together. Not a place we come to get it all right, but a place that meets our human brokenness and assures us that it's all right, and we can try again tomorrow. A place where we try and try and try and try and try. A school of love. On the other side of his time with us, I can truly say that, Dale, you have been one of that school's most compassionate, caring, dedicated, wise, and spirited teachers. Reverend Dale met St. John's and its staff in the Valley of the Shadow of Death. We were reeling, we were disoriented, and we were pretty tired. There was a sense of life, spark, and joy that was muted among us. And Dale, much like the rush of a mighty wind we hear about today, blew in at the perfect time and brought with him God's sense of life, faithfulness, purpose, and truth. Dale, I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for being the colleague, mentor, and friend that I needed, for being the truth teller, listener, learner, challenger, and pastor that our church needed. Thank you for always being up for a brisk walk to the coffee shop, for encouraging and making it possible for me to take a sabbatical, for tirelessly talking and crying through all the things that I and all of us needed to talk and cry through. Maybe it was just me. For being a person of deep faith and integrity. Thank you, Dale, for having the most eclectic, diverse, and expansive ranges of musical and lyrical knowledge of all time, for truly having a song for every, and I do mean every, occasion, and for helping so many of us find our voice. Dale, you were and are a gift from God, and your time with us shaped me and our community in powerful ways that we will not soon forget. But on this Pentecost Sunday and every day, as I said before, I'll count on the Holy Spirit to continue to connect us as one. Now, it wouldn't be an interaction with Dale or I unless one of us broke into song, so I'm going to embarrass myself for a moment. The School of Love will still be in session, of course, but for you, Dale, to quote Alice Cooper, school's out for the summer. Enjoy having that song in your head for the rest of the day. My gift to you and all of you. Blessings to you, my dear friend, and thank you so much.
Thank you, Addie. I want you to have this. I know you commented on this stole, and it's very beautiful, and I want you to have it as a way to remember me.
Thank you.
And just look.
Solo and ensemble contest. These words, as a middle schooler and a high schooler, filled me with dread. I hated the long bus ride to Redwood Falls. I hated the crummy boxed lunch. And most of all, I hated getting up as a band member and a choir member and singing a piece in front of a clinician, only to be told what we were doing wrong and how this could be better, rinse and repeat. Do you know why I disliked it so much? Because as a musician, we love just to hear ourselves play, and we don't want anybody to tell us what we're doing wrong. We could sit and play and sing for hours, and it would be great. And then when somebody tells you, well, you missed this, you could do this better, it fills us with rage, and we don't like it. We don't like it. But then, as a high schooler, I remember we were singing a piece, and the clinician said, well, why don't you breathe here instead of here? And all of a sudden, the choir went from sounding like just an average high school choir to the sound I had never heard before, all because we were told to breathe somewhere else. On a day that's full of breath, that's full of life, Dale, you have come in to this congregation and you've told us to breathe someplace new. Now, as a musician, I regularly bring in clinicians to the choirs I've led before my time here at St. John's, to the choirs here every year. And we bring in that clinician because when we sing to ourselves, and just for me, we get into ruts, we do the same things, but we bring in somebody from the outside to tell us this is how you can do better. And all of a sudden, this idea of having someone come in and tell me what's wrong didn't seem negative. It became a positive and life-giving experience because, as I learned, as a musician, as a congregant, as a human being, the best thing we can do is listen to others, and we all get better. Dale, I want to thank you for coming in, for telling me, for telling our musicians, for telling our congregation, and for telling the St. John's community where to breathe. Thank you.
Thank you. Andrew, I am going to miss you, but I know there is a Mets-Phillies game in the future for us, correct?
Right.
Right. And if you want to see Andrew unleashed, yeah, go to a ball game with him. I want to bequeath this to you, Andrew. I want this little token to be just a way to remember me and our time together here at St. John's. Yep. Amen. Thanks.
Greetings, friends, from the 150 congregations of the Pennsylvania Southeast Conference of the United Church of Christ. I am deeply, deeply honored to stand here in this moment, and to share a few words with my friend and colleague, as well as words with you all. And in just a few moments, I will lead us through the vows of farewell. Before that, I want to say that I remember the first time I met Dale. It was at your office at Emmanuel. And the first thing I saw walking into your office was an entire bookshelf of books about leadership. And I knew that you were someone I was going to need to spend a lot of time with. And we have. You are one of the very few people, and I do mean very few, probably two, with whom I would drink a beer at noontime in the middle of the day to talk about leadership issues and would want to sit at your feet for the rest of the day. You have strengthened my ministry, my soul, my heart, this impossible, odd, and wondrous calling to which God has called us. And you have done so with a grace and a patience that transcends my own. You have been a gift. Over the last many weeks, I have offered prayers about the news of your impending retirement, and I have many words of advice and counsel to offer you from the retired clergy folks that just met a couple weeks ago from around our conference. I'm going to spare you all of that. But I will say this. Retirement can look like a place that you just want to jump into. A whole lot of beach and umbrellas, a lot of fun. Retirement can also be a place where there's a whole lot of blank space and wondering, what am I going to do now? Say amen if you've been retired and you've had that experience of wondering, what are you going to do now? However, there's Helen. And I wonder if there's a list of things that you have already created to help him through this time of transition, giving him the gift of all that you need of him. Helen, I want to say to you a word of thanks for sharing Dale and supporting him as he was sharing himself and supporting all of us. And Cameron and Hannah, you didn't have a choice. Bless you for the ways that you have lived into being the children of a pastor, which is its own challenge. You are here. And just in the few moments I've spent with you, I've come to know you as incredibly spirited people in your own right. What a gift. To your dad, to all of us. And Michael, bless you for marrying Hannah and learning what it means to be in the family of a devoted and beloved pastor. Dale, for 40 years, you have kept your eyes on the one constant and consistent direction, and that is the direction the Spirit has led you. You have preached the gospel, administered the sacraments, cared for the broken, supported the weak, attended to the growth of your personal and spiritual self, celebrated the presence of the still-speaking God and met the very real fears and frustrations of leading God's people with a gracious faith and love that bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. On behalf of your colleagues in ministry, I offer prayers and thanksgiving for all that you have accomplished and beg prayers for all that God has in store for you. It is often said that pastors never retire from the ministry. As long as there's breath in their lungs, there will be good words to share, and the world needs your good words. But we never retire from being children of God and students of Jesus. Amen. And thanks be to God, we will still be together in that until God calls us home. Brothers and sisters in St. John's, Pastor Dale is leaving, but God is not. And despite the fact that you have an incredible pastor in Pastor Addie, she is not God. She is not the Messiah. She is not the caretaker or salvation bringer of this or any other congregation, but she is an amazing pastor. The scriptures are filled with stories of leadership transitions from Moses to Joshua to Elijah to Elisha, from Jesus to the disciples to us. And every one of those stories is about the power and the promise of God to continue to guide God's people in those transitions, as God is most certainly guiding you now. As Addie pointed out in her children's sermon, you are part of a much wider church, the body of Christ, and this small portion of it, the United Church of Christ. And on behalf of our conference, Reverend Kevin McLemore and I and the rest of the conference staff, the North Penn Association, and all 30,000 members of the Pennsylvania Southeast Conference have their eyes on you for the gift that you are as a church of the United Church of Christ, the inspiration that you bring to it, and the historic and storied traditions that will carry you long into a new future. Don't miss the opportunity to be part of that. Dale, for you, on behalf of the conference, in gratitude for pastoral service, the Pennsylvania Southeast Conference of the United Church of Christ recognizes and celebrates that the Reverend Dale Davis Jr. was ordained to ministry in the United Church of Christ November 25th, 1984, and has served long and faithfully and is awarded this citation for pastoral service upon his retirement with gratitude and appreciation, presented on this 19th day of May, signed by the Reverend Dr. Karen Georgia Thompson, General Minister and President of the United Church of Christ, and myself. Wow. God bless you, brother.
Thank you. Love you. Love you.
We have words for everything in the United Church of Christ. There were words spoken the day that Dale was ordained. There were words spoken on all the installation services that brought him to the congregations he has served in his 40-year career. And now there are words of release, words letting him go and sending him and his family on their way to what God has in store for them next. And so, friends, I ask, do you, the members and friends of St. John's United Church of Christ, release the Reverend Dale Davis from the duties of pastor of St. John's so that he may move into retirement and what God has in store for him next? If so, please so. Please say, so that he can hear it with all the love in your heart, we do with the help of God.
We do.
And do you offer him your encouragement as his life and ministry unfold in new ways? Same thing, we do with the help of God.
We do with the help of God.
Do you, Reverend Dale Davis, release the members and friends of St. John's from turning to you and depending on you? If so, please say, I do with the help of God.
I do with the help of God.
And do you offer your encouragement for the continuing ministry here and on the relationship with another pastor who will come to serve? If so, please say, I do with the help of God.
I do with the help of God.
On behalf of the Pennsylvania Southeast Conference of the United Church of Christ, I witness to the words spoken, words of thankfulness, forgiveness, release. The member churches of the North Penn Association and our conference hold each of you in prayer. We pledge our support in the transitions that are signified in this service, and I invite you to join me in prayer as it is printed in your bulletin. O God, we give thanks for remembered times when we together have shared the life of faith. We thank you for the moments we have shared with Reverend Dale in worship, in learning, and in service. We pray that Dale will be aware of your Spirit's guidance as he moves to whatever new beginning awaits. In the name of Christ we pray, amen.
I'm sure you have an appetite by now. I do want to recognize Reverend Thomas Addle. Tom, would you please stand? Just so that folks know that St. John's... So Tom is going to, he's the bridge...
He's our bridge support pastor.
Support pastor. Yes. So God bless you, Tom.
Okay. Well, with that, I do want to take a moment before you head downstairs to bless the food. So consider the food that is shared blessed. May it nourish us, body and soul, to continue to be people of the Pentecost Church, people continuing to spread the good news, the Spirit, the surprise of the Holy Spirit in our midst. And now I want to invite you, before you go, to share the peace of Christ with one another. Head downstairs, grab something to eat, find someone that you don't know. There's plenty of people here this morning that you don't know. Let them know you are glad they are here. And then as you head downstairs, as you go out into the world, as you go about your week, please know that the love of God surrounds you, the peace of Christ enfolds you, and the power of God's Holy Spirit goes with you this day and every day. Amen.